1, 2, 3. Books. Books. Sometimes they suck. Books. Books. They make us say fuck. Two Trouts.
In Search of an Author.
Well, welly, well, well, well. Welcome to Two Trouts in Search of an Author. I'm David.
And I'm Jai.
And this week's author is Robert Silverberg.
And the book is Downward to the Earth.
This is our first Hugo Award winning author.
Yes, we were unaware that Robert Silverberg won a Hugo Award for this book.
Yep.
So with that being said, we like this book. It's an actual good book. This podcast is going to be full of spoilers.
And we actually kind of care about that.
Yes, so if you guys want to read this book, you might want to skip this podcast until after you've read it.
Right.
Because we definitely recommend to go out and read this book.
Downward to the Earth, Robert Silverberg.
So,
check it out.
So after this, we're going to just dive right into spoilers.
So pause the video, go on Amazon, buy it for like
a cent.
10 cents. Yeah, a cent. And then come back once it arrives and you've read it.
Yes.
Now. Welcome back. Okay.
All right.
Now that everyone's on the same page.
Okay. Well, here's the plot to Downward to the Earth by Robert Silverberg. Downward to the Earth takes place on Holman's world, as known to the imperialistic Earth people. It is known to the natives as Belzegor. Ooh. The natives consist of large elephant creatures known as the Nildor. Nildor Roar. They kind of switch back and forth.
Yeah, I think it's a tense thing or plural thing. I don't know.
Who were enslaved by the humans, but they have recently been freed. And then there's a race of shaggy, bipedal, taper-like creatures called the Sulidoror. I'm going to mispronounce every name.
That's why you're reading it, for the hilarity.
Nildor generally are really intelligent. The Sulidoror, not so much. The Nildor, they can't build anything. They have no written language, no concept of privacy. They're elephants. They can't do this.
Yeah.
Okay. The book focuses on Edmund Gunderson, who returns after 10 years away from the planet. Gunderson makes a pilgrimage across the planet to Mist Country, which is the sacred place to the Nildor. As he does, he, you know, runs into old friends when he worked for the company. Heavy air quotes.
Yes.
To get to the Mist Country, Edmund Gunderson, or as they call him, Edmund Gunderson. He promises the Nildor Elder that he's allowed to travel into Mist Country on the condition that he brings a former colleague named Cullen back to be purified by the Nildoror. He travels with a group of Nildor on their way to the ritual of rebirth, a mysterious sacred rite which no man has ever seen and lived. He befriends his Nildor companion, Sringahar of the First Birth, and they talk about philosophy. Quite a bit.
Yes, a lot.
On his travels, Gunderson runs into a former lover named Sina. We kind of learn why Gunderson has come back to the planet. He wants to kind of know more about rebirth and kind of maybe attempt the rebirth ritual. He has a lot of guilt over a lot of shit he did on Belzegor, a lot of atrocities. He denied 6 Nildor the right of rebirth by making them build up a dam. Sina is kind of horrified about that. She knows someone that went through rebirth, and we kind of see what happens. They kind of fall into comas and become terrifying bug monsters.
Not a good way to go.
No, Gunderson's kind of freaked out about this, but he wants to keep going. In Mist Country, Gunderson does encounter said Cullen, the one he's supposed to bring back, and he is dying of cancer. He refuses treatment, he refuses to let Gunderson take him back, which was a contract. Gunderson told the Nildor Elder that he would not, that he would not bring Cullen back if he did not want to come back on his own free will. He tells Gunderson why the Nildor want him. It was because he witnessed a sacred ritual in this bizarre plateau, which is kind of a sinister place, where these normally peaceful Nildor participated in acts of slaughter against herds of animals, thus purifying themselves through violence, and they also danced.
And they danced.
Cullen refuses to go back because he would have to participate in that same rite in order to cleanse himself, and he refuses to give up his civilized attitude. Soon after telling Gunderson this, he dies, and Gunderson moves on. Gunderson, all alone, marches across the Land of Mists towards the Mountain of Rebirth. He arrives and witnesses the secret of rebirth. The truth is that Nildor and Sulidor are in fact a single species, and the rite of rebirth is where one metamorphs into the other. Nildor to Sulidor, and vice versa, spreading their consciousness across the whole of the planet as they do. The reason men turn into horrible bug monsters is because humans have no companion form, and so Earthmen become what their souls say they are. With all of this in mind, Gunderson submits to rebirth. Then after a super psychedelic drug-fueled dream sequence,
so great,
Gunderson becomes one with the universe and touches the souls of everyone he's met during his journey. He then begins to attain his true form. He wakes up, reawakened, and teams up with his newly reborn best bro for life, Sringahar, a.k.a. Timunili? Yeah. The Sulidor. And he becomes...
Space Jesus.
The
It is
end.
The story of a man becoming Space Jesus.
Yes, it is... It's a good book.
It's a good book. It is a little bit ridiculous, but
yes, we'll
in
get
a great
into
way.
That.
Obviously, it's science fiction.
Yes, it's very... It's a science fiction.
Yeah, it takes place in... 22... What is it? I wrote it down. 2240 was 8 years ago, as far as this.
So 2248.
Yeah, 2248.
And when was this published?
This was published in 1971. Hmm. Or 1969. Yeah, according to the copyrights in the front of the book. So, well into the 60s.
Yes.
Well into the hippie movement.
Yes. Shall we go into the mechanics?
Yes, mechanics. What was this book? How's the book built?
Well, it's...
It is a journey of one man, kind of... One man's self-discovery,
yeah,
basically.
It is very much... not very... Kind of travelogue-esque, I'd say. I kind of got some, like, Tolkien,
mm-hmm.
like, Hobbit vibes with him walking through this strange land.
Appropriate. Hippies loved Lord of the Rings.
Yeah. Yeah. It's written well. I like how it's written. I mean, it drops... What's that word? In the very beginning?
Yes, it drops a... What is the word? Dysmenorrheal. Dysmenorrheal.
Yes.
The tourist wife's lips tightened in that thin, pinched, dysmenorrheal way of hers, to use it in a sentence.
Yeah.
It apparently means, like, menstruating. Like, PMSing.
Yeah, which, okay.
So, that was...
It kind of drops that. After that, I mean, the language is a bit easier to understand. Alien names, kind of a bit... funky. They all have apostrophes. I don't know how to pronounce half these things.
Yeah, I did my best to kind of make up pronunciations. It very heavily uses symbolism.
Oh yes, it's heavily symbolic. It's very psychedelic.
Yeah.
Very psychedelic.
But yeah, half the characters, or all of the characters, are... Basically, stand-ins for ideas.
Yes.
Stand-ins for ideas, stand-ins for symbols, mm-hmm. kind of...
Very, I guess, like, turn-of-the-century French writers, how they...
Yes.
Kind of... Well, you know, the symbolist writers.
the symbolist writers.
Fancy that. Yeah, honestly, I don't have much on mechanics, because
It's basically how the book was written.
Yeah, it's fairly straightforward, fairly kind of sci-fi, 60s, 70s,
yeah.
kind of...
Towards the end, there is a
yes.
a long chapter, chapter 16, where that's the super psychedelic chapter where he takes mind-altering drugs and becomes one with the universe. And it has an odd tense change, which is, I'm sure, on purpose.
It goes definitely into present tense.
Yeah, the entire book is in past tense. It goes into present tense while he's high on this...
venom.
Yeah, this weird snake venom.
Which we didn't mention in the summary.
We'll go into that when we actually get into the story.
Yeah.
And, yeah, that's a cool chapter.
It's just a very good chapter. Well, shall we move on to what's next on the agenda?
Yeah, I think so. I think that's probably
Yeah, that's all it. We have for mechanics.
We could talk about the themes.
Yes.
And themings.
Okay. It's obviously very religious.
Yes.
He does turn into a space Jesus. Like,
he literally turns into space Jesus.
He goes through rebirth. He looks down at himself. He looks normal. He looks in the mirror. He's a horrible bug creature.
Right. So he might have turned into a horrifying bug monster.
Yes.
So horrifying bug Jesus.
But he keeps going, I am one with the universe, etc.
Shall I just read out what he says? Because
yes.
That makes it absolutely clear. A blast of cold wind struck the mountainside. Sparkling flakes of snow whirled into Gunderson's face. He smiled. He had never felt so free, so light, so young. A vision of a mankind transformed blazed within him. I am the emissary, he thought. I am the bridge over which they shall cross. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in the darkness, but shall have the light of life. A new commandment I give unto thee, that ye love one another. Man, like, whoa.
Yeah, it's obviously a lot of themes of rebirth, rediscovering yourself.
Yeah. It's never too late to start over, to find God, to find purpose, stuff like that.
Yeah. There's a lot of, like, becoming one with nature.
Yeah. It looks down on those who deny their spirituality.
Yes.
It does do that, so, you know, whatever.
So, honestly, it's a little bit refreshing for a sci-fi book, I guess. I mean, I don't know. I guess I haven't read a lot of sci-fi.
To not be, like, staunchly atheist.
Yeah, like, it's almost a little bit refreshing to see it take a more kind of religious standpoint.
In contrast, I just read Dune, like, a few weeks ago, which is kind of staunchly,
yeah,
a little bit atheist.
When, like, I usually think of sci-fi stuff, I usually think of... There is the spiritual side to some sci-fi stuff, but a lot of the times it's serving a greater purpose.
Yeah.
And a lot of the times they're definitely more atheistic.
Yeah. In Dune, what he does is he uses, like, religion through the universe as this thing to entrap people and kind of enslave people and manipulate people.
Yeah.
And through the whole of it, the Butlerian Jihad is this thing that's going to happen in the future that we have to, or maybe just a jihad in general, is the thing in the future that the main character has to overcome or make sure doesn't happen. So, religion's kind of scary in Dune.
In this,
it's kind of nice. Religion is a...
Let me ask you.
Yeah.
When does Sting come in?
Sting?
Yeah, you know, Dune.
Oh, right. Right, the spice must flow, etc., etc.
Etc., yeah. David Lynch's 1980s Dune.
Watch it.
Don't watch it.
No, that was
seriously
bad.
Don't.
That was bad advice.
Instead, watch the documentary Alejandro Jodorowsky's Dune.
Or just read the goddamn book.
Yeah.
It's a good
book.
Anyway. Onto the book we're actually talking about.
Yes, yes.
themes.
Yeah, a lot of Mother Earth, like when he's talking to the Nildor. They're talking about Grok, which is...
basically the soul.
Yeah, the soul. And they have a long conversation about, you know, what things have souls and don't have souls. And the Nildor kind of chastises Edmund Gunderson, like... listen, more things have souls than you think, so you gotta keep your mind open.
Yeah. How do you know elephants don't have souls?
Yeah. How do you know monkeys don't have souls?
Yeah.
How do you know trees don't have souls? There is that part where, he, like, listened to the grass or something like that? I can't remember exactly.
Something like that, yeah. There's some Pocahontas.
Mm-hmm.
Pocahontas shit in there.
Painting all the colors of the wind and whatnot.
Yeah. Also, hippies.
Yes.
Hippies.
It's
turn on, tune in, drop out.
It's it's very much a part of the hippie movement.
Yeah.
It is very much a product of its time.
But it's got some things to say about it.
Yes.
Addiction.
Yes.
About addiction and drug use in particular.
There's this venom that Kurtz, which I don't think we mentioned him in the summary.
Yeah, he's
the guy that's at Cena's place that transformed into a horrible bug monster.
Yes.
Because he went rebirth.
But he wasn't ready, and it
yeah.
transformed him into what his soul said he was,
mm-hmm.
which apparently was a horrifying bug monster.
But the thing with him is he smuggled this venom that they use during rebirth.
Yes.
And he took it recreationally, like in small doses. It wouldn't, like, do too much damage. But he did it recreationally. He gave it to some of the Nildor, which
yeah.
they took recreationally, which is kind of a don't do that. It's
yeah.
for rebirth only.
Yeah. Messes them up.
Yeah.
Get it? White people are using recreationally a substance that the native peoples think is
yeah
is sacred. Get it?
Yeah.
Get it?
I guess
peyote, tobacco.
There's also a big theme of
There's a bit of that. A little imperialism.
Yeah, yeah. There's a
for
big
good
thing
measure
about hey imperialism kind of sucks.
Yeah. But yeah, the author Silverberg obviously is of the opinion that drugs should not be used recreationally.
Yes.
And should be used for the purpose of expanding one's consciousness.
Yes.
And
feed your head.
Feed your head.
Etc.
Etc. Go ask Alice.
Yeah.
Or your parents. And you know what I like? The thing on the cover that
yes.
you can see, the naked lady with
well,
all the psychedelic covers.
On our blog, it has a couple yes. covers, but this is the best cover.
This is the one that we picked up and that got us to pick up the book. Actually happens.
Yes, it is so good.
Yes. On page 96, basically there's just this creature on the planet.
Cena. Like,
that Cena wears like clothes,
mm-hmm.
and it's all psychedelic colors. And then all the rest of the time, she just walks around naked, because sex is no big thing.
Yeah. Whatever.
Whatever. Whatever.
Free love, man.
Free love.
Free love.
Oy. All right. So those were the themes in the cover
yeah.
judgment.
Shall we go on to stuff we don't like about this
yeah.
book?
Let's talk about some specific things we don't like.
All right.
And then we can take up the rest of the time just talking about the book, because there's a lot to
yes.
get into. So what didn't we like?
I thought he went a bit overboard on describing the environments.
Oh?
Personally.
Yeah?
I felt that's kind of why I got a lot of Tolkien-esque type of stuff from it.
Yeah,
I felt he spent a little bit of time kind of describing the world rather than moving the plot on.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, it's not that bad. It's a short book, so...
Yeah. Like 176
yeah.
pages.
It's not too long, so it didn't really put a big damper on it. But there were a few times where I'm all like, oh, here's, like, the exciting stuff happening. And it kind of takes a dip into, like, a few paragraphs of him describing the environment. And it's a very, like, pretty environment.
Yeah, it's very lush.
He builds the world really well. But after a bit, I was all like, I kind of can get this, like, foresty world
yeah.
with weird psychedelic things.
I guess the point of it is to make sure that the reader falls in love with this planet as much as
yeah.
Gunderson is. Like,
am I going to have a post-Pandora depression?
You're going to want to paint yourself blue and traipse around the park.
I'm going to want to become an elephant.
Yes!
Going to take a lot of peyote and become a big bug creature.
That's... Yes. fantastic.
That was kind of my big
thing.
There's a little bit of
that Dances with Wolves.
Yeah.
Sort of thing in there.
But I don't think it's as bad as Dances with Wolves, because I don't like Dances with Wolves, and I like this book.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was kind of my big thing. I sometimes felt the pacing kind of was a bit awkward. Not too bad. And then I think the thing we can both agree on, it's a bit preachy.
Bit preachy. That was going to be mine.
Yeah.
Yeah. From, you know, every single thing in the book kind of conspires to make you feel bad about being white.
Yeah.
You know? Which, you know, I guess white people problems.
I mean, I already feel bad about being white, cisgendered, everything else, so whatever.
Right. And then towards the end, it gets preachy in a different way when it gets all super space Jesus.
Yeah, it gets really religious.
It does get a little bit on your nerves.
Is definitely like an actual preaching.
Yeah, literal preaching.
Mm-hmm.
So, it was well handled, I think, but it was there, and
yeah,
as I was reading it, I was like, alright, I get it, you're space Jesus.
Yeah, it kind of dipped into some campy stuff.
I get it, we're all connected, war's bad, man.
Really corny stuff, but
That's why chapter 16 and 17 become Comedy of the Year 1971 if you put, you know, man, like, whoa, after every paragraph.
Ah, yes.
Like, the cosmos streams with shining tears, and on that salty river Gunderson floats, traveling without will, visiting this world and that, drifting among the nebulae, passing through clouds of cosmic dust, soaring over strange suns. You know, man? Like, whoa.
Whoa, like, whoa.
He's not alone. Nasinisil is with him, and Sringahar, and Volhimyor, and all the others. You know, man? Like, whoa.
Whoa.
Like that.
What if, like, life is like a dream, you know, man? And, like, when you die, you wake up. Like, whoa, man.
That's not from the book.
No. Just to make it clear, David was quoting the book. I was not.
Yeah, except for the you know, man, like, whoa. Although you could put them in, and it would not change the tone of the book at all.
Yeah, it gets really kind of hippie dippy, whoa, expand your mind. I think it's fun.
It is extremely fun. But
I think that's fun.
It's kind of fun to the detriment of the book.
Yes.
Like, you're not laughing with the book, you're laughing at the book at that point.
So yeah, that's kind of stuff that we're not big on, but the good news is that we do like this book.
Yeah,
so there's a lot of stuff I do like about
this
book.
Yeah, it's not enough to make me go, nah, it's crap. Preachy crap.
Yeah.
So I think we could get to just talking about the book for the rest of the podcast.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot to get into.
Mm-hmm. So
I actually really liked how well drawn the environment was.
Just to
fly in the face of your criticism.
All right.
I think that an entire lake that is alcoholic was kind of cool.
Yeah. Don't get me wrong. The environment is very good. I just felt, especially towards the end when he's going into Mist Country and he's like going up to the plateau, I kind of felt like there was a lot of plot happening, and I wanted it to continue to happen, and he kind of stopped for little, like, scenic breaks here and there.
Mm-hmm.
And I felt that kind of disrupted the pacing.
I thought of another criticism, going back to things we don't like. I think that because all of the characters are such stark...
Oh, yeah.
Like, symbols, that they're not really people.
Yeah.
Except for Gunderson. Gunderson's
the only guy
is well-rounded and has depth, but basically everyone else in the story is there to either teach Gunderson a lesson or to reflect something about humankind in general.
Yeah, which is... I think it works well in the book.
But on the other hand, I think it's really cool how you can kind of connect up all of the characters with their symbols.
Yeah. It's not too obtuse.
It makes you feel... It's a book that makes you feel smart because it's really easy to figure out the symbolism. It's not very subtle.
No, but...
It's like shooting fish in a barrel. Really literary fish in a barrel. I think that the company is the same company from Alien.
Oh,
okay. I'm just going to say that. That's my headcanon.
All right.
It is the same company from Alien / Prometheus.
So this is our pet theories?
Downward to the Earth is totally canon with Aliens.
I think it's totally canon with Footloose.
Oh, yeah, that's true. It is.
Footloose.
We should talk about Ecclesiastes 3.
Yes, this book's title, Downward to the Earth, takes its title from Ecclesiastes 3.
The Bible verse.
Yay!
I'm going to read a very little bit of it because it is basically the plot of the book.
Yes.
At the beginning of the book, they have a quote from Ecclesiastes, and this is the passage that the quote is from. I also said to myself, as for humans, God tests them so that they may see that they are like the animals. Surely the fate of human beings is like that of the animals. The same fate awaits them both. As one dies, so dies the other. All have the same breath. Humans have no advantage over the animals. Everything is meaningless. All go to the same place, all come from dust, and to dust all return. Who knows if the human spirit rises upward and if the spirit of the animal goes downward to the earth? That's the New International Version if you want to look up which Bible that's from. And that's also basically almost word for word Sringahar and Gunderson's debate on whether or not elephants have souls.
Yes, and that's also that's the plot, you know. Everything gets reborn, everything's the same. Book didn't have quite as nihilistic of tone as nothing matters, but...
Yeah. And in fact, he's kind of down on nihilism in general.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Because one of the characters symbolizes human nihilism.
Yes.
Ecclesiastes
3, the reason why it fits with Footloose is, if you do not know this verse, it is there is a time for everything, and a season for every activity under the heavens. A time to be born, a time to die, etc., etc. A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, and a time to dance.
Dancing is not a crime.
Yes, and this they quote this in Footloose.
Suck it, John Leguizamo.
So, I don't know how the characters exactly line up, but Footloose, it's definitely a future Footloose.
It's a retelling of Footloose in the future.
Yes, I mean, there's the whole dance with the Nildors.
And they danced.
And they danced, and also massacred a lot of animals. Kind of like how Kevin Bacon danced and slaughtered all of their values.
We're not actually talking about the book anymore.
No, not at all. We're talking about Footloose. Anyway, back to the book.
Okay, so the planet is called Holman's World. This is interesting. I did a little research, and there's a painter called William Holman Hunt. Holman Hunt converted to Christianity while painting something called The Light of the World. It's this famous picture of basically Jesus knocking on your door.
Mm-hmm.
And... The phrase light of the world is thrown around a lot, as you heard in the super preachy last paragraph of the book. So that's interesting. The planet is literally named after a guy who converted
which
while toiling on his life's work.
Mm-hmm. Which says a bit about the main character, maybe a little bit about Robert Silverberg.
Yeah.
Who knows?
Possibly.
Didn't do a lot of research into the author this week, unfortunately.
I did a little bit, but not very much. Basically enough to know that he's Hugo Award winning.
Yes, which
and that
is
he probably
really weird
demands respect.
Like, I've never heard of this author or this book, and I'm not like big into sci-fi, but I know a lot of the bigger names.
Yeah,
and it's kind of weird that this slipped under my radar.
I kind of didn't want to know more because. I liked extrapolating ideas about what Robert Silverberg's big ideas were through the values we can see in his book.
Yeah.
We can tell he's big into free love.
Yes.
Because all of the characters who are terrible people, like the tourists, there's these reoccurring tourists who are the worst people, the worst of humanity.
Yes, tourists that come down to Belzegor and they just see the Nildorors as, like, oh, they're elephants.
Yeah, just and empty-headed animals.
And they're slaves. They expect them to carry their luggage.
And, of course, these tourists, you know, walk around like herd animals, kind of ruminating about stupid things. So that was a little irony there. But at one point, they see some Nildor just having sex on the beach, and they're horrified.
Yeah.
But elsewhere in the book, like, Sina is completely free love. Gunderson is free love. Kurtz is free love. Everyone's all about the free love.
Yeah.
And Robert Silverberg probably is, too, because only bad people are anti-sex. Andy's got big ideas about, like we said before, the addiction and recreational drug use.
He's not big on alcohol or drugs, surprisingly.
Was it a hippie thing to renounce alcohol?
Fun fact, I don't think in general, but a personal connection for me, my parents, what's his name?
I don't know if I wrote it down.
No, I think it's Robert Bryant.
Uh-huh.
My parents know Robert Bryant, who founded the Wharf Rats, which are a group of deadheads that abstain from drugs and alcohol.
Deadheads being Grateful Dead fans, right?
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah. Grateful Dead fans.
In case you don't know.
My parents being the biggest hippies fucking ever.
Which is why I was... I knew you'd knew this. You'd know this.
Yes, they have a personal connection with this anti-drug and alcohol kind of organization that was kind of founded by these hippies. Of course, my parents really weren't a part of that, but
yeah,
they did their fair share of psychedelics, but
naturally,
but they do, I like, even my parents now abstain from alcohol. I don't think it was a general hippie thing, but I do think I think from Robert Silverberg's perspective, he was smart enough to know that abuse is not a good thing.
I wonder if Silverberg listened to the Grateful Dead.
Probably.
Probably, yeah.
This was 1969, 1971. Probably.
Probably. All right. So, we keep talking about how people equal symbols in this book. Let's talk about some of those people who are symbols.
All right.
So, Sina... It's very clear that Sina, the love interest, quote-unquote, the girl...
Yeah, the single female character.
Her big thing is that she appears to have become a nihilist.
Yeah.
And that is her horrible, horrifying character trait.
I think I was getting, if we're going to draw from, like, Seven Deadly Sins...
Yeah?
I think she... Well, I don't know. She was a bit tricky, because at first I attributed lust... But then it's kind of free love.
Because that's...
Who the fuck cares about lust?
Because it's easy to just hook lust up to the one girl in the story.
Yeah, and like...
You sexist.
Ah, I'm sorry, but she walked around naked and...
Yeah, true.
Wanted to sleep with him, even though she was already married. I'm sorry. It gave me all the ammo.
Yeah, true.
But I don't think because of the free love aspect... And, like, fuck lust. Like,
yeah.
Seriously.
Yeah, I'm not sure if it lines up cleanly to the Seven Deadly Sins.
No, definitely not. I was trying to make a connection, but... she might be a little bit pride, I'd say. But...
Maybe. Her big thing is that she married Kurtz, who was... A huge asshole.
Yes.
But, and also a drug
monster.
Abuser, and now a bug monster. And now she's basically taking care of his horrifying comatose corpse.
Mm-hmm.
And she is kind of given up on life.
Yeah.
And she wants Gunderson to stay with her and give up on life, too.
Yeah, she's very, like, well, ironically robotic. She has a robot butler.
Yeah.
And the robot butler kind of informs Gunderson, hey, Kurtz is here. You should talk to the lady of the house about that. And
yeah.
But she's kind of mechanical with her motions. Seems very emotionless.
Yeah. minor character from the beginning who's kind of the head of the tourists. He's showing them around.
Yes.
His name is Van Binneker. And we see him... When we first see him, he shares a drink of alcohol with Gunderson, and they've got this gross invention that he thought of.
Oh, wow, I forgot about that.
It's called an alcohol snout. You basically just inject the alcohol directly into your veins.
Oh.
Which is gross. But yeah, Van Beneker has obviously become an alcoholic.
Yeah.
And Kurtz has become like a strung out like meth head.
Uh-huh.
Who's, you know, reached the point where he's been destroyed by the drugs.
Mm-hmm. Gunderson does not want any of that shit.
Yeah. And Cullen, the guy that Gunderson is searching for, he's, I think his thing is that he's actively running away from his guilt rather than embracing it.
Yes, he does not want to really atone for his sins.
Exactly.
I did some nasty shit, but I'm gonna just hide from it.
Yeah.
And die from cancer.
And die from cancer, abruptly.
Yeah, very abruptly.
And Katz, again, seems to me to be a harsh criticism of born-again Christians who convert at the very last minute.
Yeah.
Like, I can do all of the horrible things I want in life as long as I, like...
Jog to the finish line at the last minute.
Repent.
I'm dying. Oh, wait, I found God!
Yeah, because he submits to rebirth.
Yes.
Like, he did all these horrible things, and then out of some sense of either guilt or just, oh, I ought to do this so I can feel good about myself, he goes and submits to rebirth, and then he comes back a comatose, horrifying bug monster.
Uh-huh.
Filled with rage and longing for what could have been, I guess. So yeah, that's an interesting thing that I read into it.
Well, I mean, they're obviously symbols, so
yes.
Kind of have to read into it.
And what else?
Well,
the environment itself is...
Oh yeah, even though I like criticize it, I do think it's a very nice environment. I got a honestly, heavy Fantastic Planet vibes from this book.
Yes, the Fantastic Planet.
Which is a great movie if you haven't seen it. It's also one that's very concerned with environment. It kind of does it through its animation, though. But
yeah.
I was getting a lot of, like, psychedelic alien planet with weird vegetation and... No beasts of combat, unfortunately.
No beasts of battle!
But, yeah, the environment, it was very lushly drawn.
Yes, and dangerous.
Yes.
The whole book is kind of entrenched in this idea that the planet is reclaiming all of the human settlements that have been abandoned. So Gunderson is always coming across these, like, outposts and buildings that are getting all encroached with vines and...
I really like the jungle. Like, how it was... a bygone era of imperialism where they came, they built this stuff, and then they just abandoned it.
Yeah, that's a striking symbol.
Yeah.
I was trying to find a better word for it.
Let's count how many times we use the word symbol in this episode.
Yeah, play it home, boys and girls. Take a shot.
Bingo charts.
Take a shot every time we say symbolism.
Well, we don't want them to become alcoholics.
That's true. Alcoholism is bad, remember?
Yeah. Just take a hit of LSD.
There we go. Take a hit of LSD every time.
Only to find yourself.
Only to expand your brain.
I don't know.
Anything else that you liked about it?
It's a good book. Just straight up, it's good.
Well written. Well drawn main character.
Yeah.
Not so well drawn side characters.
Yeah, they don't really need to be. It's all about Gunderson.
Yeah. It's literary in that way. But, you know, it's just the one guy's journey to self-discovery and finding a way to become Space Jesus.
Yeah.
I like Sringahar of the First Birth.
Oh, yeah, the Nildor that accompanies Edmund Gunderson.
In the Footloose parable matchup, he would be the cowboy that Kevin Bacon befriends and teaches how to dance.
Except
the other way around.
Yes, because...
Instead, it's the cowboy teaching Kevin Bacon how to dance.
Yes, because there is a scene where the Nildor start dancing, and Edwin Gunderson's kind of sitting by like, oh, this is kind of weird. And they're like, come on, dance with us. And he's like, I don't want to disrespect you. And they're like, dance.
Do it. That would be like the scene in the construction site where he... Well, Kevin Bacon doesn't really dance. He just does, like, flips and gymnastics.
Man, so when are we going to start our Footloose podcast?
I think this is already our first episode.
Honestly, I don't have much to talk about this book. It's good.
Yeah.
It's a bit obvious. So, really, we kind of tackled the obvious stuff.
Yeah. Downward to the Earth, Robert Silverberg, probably like 2 cents on Amazon.
Yeah, like 176 pages. If you can, try to get the cover with the psychedelic woman.
Yes, we will post a picture of it.
There's a lot of covers with a really boring, like, a man and an elephant in a forest.
Like the art, like the, these are the nice covers that we put for
it's
the literary editions.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of boring. I mean, this is definitely a podcast where we judge books by their covers.
And yeah, we made a good call this time.
Yes, it's a very good cover for a very good book.
Yeah.
And
I guess that's about it.
Yeah, anything else you'd like to mention? Anything you'd like to plug? Anything you'd like to, I don't know. What do people do in podcasts at the end?
I don't know. It's just...
TwoTrouts.tumblr.com!
TwoTrouts.tumblr.com!
Follow us at TwoTrouts at Twitter!
Yeah. Nice plug. Nice plug there. Turn on, tune in, drop out. That's our lesson for today.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. What's our... How would you rate this book?
Oh, fuck. The rating. Shit. I think I would rate it about...
How many hits of LSD would you take for this book?
Ooh, I'd say, like, 8 hits out of 1 fantastic planet.
There we go. Alright. I'd probably take, like, 8 hits out of El Topo and the Holy Mountain.
Haha, nice. Going back to Alejandro Jodorowsky. Anyway.
Look it up.
I mentioned his Dune earlier.
Yeah.
Anyway, obviously we would recommend this book. We said so at the beginning.
We keep saying it.
Yes.
We keep saying it over and over again.
Because I'm surprised. I expected this podcast to be mostly bad books.
I did too, honestly.
Like,
yeah, we could just talk about that for a while. How flabbergasted we are that we got...
found a Hugo Award winner. Like...
just... tucked in,
mm-hmm.
with yellow pages and...
a little bit beat up spine.
A little bit battle damage.
But...
one of the other books, spoilers, is also pretty good.
I'm,
and I know that the one that you're reading is...
The one I'm reading is
okay.
Good in a kind of funny, campy way.
Okay. So that's some stuff to look forward to.
This one's actually good.
Mine's good in a funny, campy way, too.
Yeah.
So... I think that's about right.
Yeah.
We are Two Trouts in search of an author. Our author this week was Robert Silverberg, of all people.
Yes, Downward to the Earth. I guess one Hugo Awards is maybe an established name.
Yeah, look him up.
Yeah. Well, I suppose that's it. Until next week.
Until next week.
Farewell.